this in the I'm using the Dirac's Bryant cat notation. So let this state n represent the eigenstate of this operator capital N, which is a dagger A. Okay. So this is the eigenstate of this operator with eigenvalue this. Okay. That's my statement. This is the eigenstate of this operator with this eigenvalue little n. Okay. In that case, I would find that just using simple commutation relations, okay, you can obtain this because n is a dagger times a, okay. So then this a dagger times this state n, this is the eigenstate of this operator with eigenvalue n plus 1. And this a n is the eigenstate of this operator with the eigenvalue n minus 1. So what is happening that this guy is reducing the eigenvalue by 1 unit and this guy is increasing the eigenvalue by 1 unit. Okay. So very good. You can obtain further more insight into these things. Now, where is this H? So, if I apply this operator to this state N, so what happens? H cross omega N plus 1 half N, then this gives me H cross omega. Just I have used n operating on n to give me little n operating on the state vector little n. Okay, then this you can write as en n, and these are your energy eigenvalues h cross omega n plus 1 half. Okay, now very soon we would realize that before I erase these objects from here, before I erase these expressions from here, I would like to make a statement that this in fact expressing x and p as linear sums of a and a dagger is actually so called Fock space decomposition of this of these operators x and p. Here, if these are operators on the right hand side, on the left hand side, also have to be operators. So here, x and p are also operators. Okay? And so this actually is the Fock space decomposition of x and px. Okay? In terms of, here we have put e to the power minus ikx or e to the power plus ikx n bar. Okay? So they are not carrying any momentum dependence. In a short while, I will write this expression for, let us say, for a real scalar field theory, then things will become a little more transparent. Okay? But you see, this algebra would continue to remain the same. And here you have this energy eigenvalue. So you see, it's enough to define just this one step, that this is the eigenstate of this operator with this eigenvalue. Then all this rest of things you can convey. And then at the end, what you want to do? So we want to obtain, so these are the energy eigenvalues, Hamiltonian is also an operator, and eventually you can calculate the commutation relations between A and A dagger, which will be 1 here in this case, and A would be 0, and A dagger and A dagger would be 0. So once you calculate the expression for the, this is the quantized energy. You look, this n, we will shortly find what is this little n. This little n is a number which takes value 0, 1, 2, 3. And there is no upper limit on this. I will prove it just now. Okay? And that happens because without being told, we are considering a bosonic system. So here everything is bosonic. All the variables are bosonic variables, no fermions. We will later on also consider fermionic oscillator. Okay? So a few things I might, and once I would calculate the quantized energy, and I would calculate these commutation relations for A and A dagger, etc., I would call that this would be second quantization. I would explain the physics behind it, okay? Little bit more, but algebraically. So it's a part of the description of the Fock space. So in Fock space, automatically this product A dagger times A, which represents a number operator, which we define as the number operator, this if we obtain its matrix representation, it would come out to be a diagonal matrix. Okay, I just now prove it. And here the N would commute with N, so these two properties, they go, actually one means the other, so it's only one property. If N is diagonal, and N is going to commute with N. Okay, you can very easily prove N is, so N is A dagger A, so obtain a commutation relation of A dagger A with A dagger A. So it's a commutation relation of AB with AB. And here A is A dagger and B is A, and you can make use of this last property, which also you can prove. So you can actually, everything follows from our basic definitions like this and this. And so matrix representation for N would be a diagonal representation. I can explicitly obtain this expression, and to, at that point of time, people may not have realized, but you see, all these techniques, they are applicable all the way up to string theory and superstring theory. So, this, okay, I might leave this, okay, let me leave this. If needed, I can write again. So, now, just to give you an analogy here, let me write down this thing. I will come back to quantum mechanics again, but let me give you an example of a real scalar field theory. Okay, so this is defined by 1/2 d mu phi minus 1/2 m square phi square, and you then consider the Fock space decomposition of phi. So phi, you can do one of the two. Phi square k a of k minus this plus a dagger of k t to the power plus I to the x, and kx, here we need to know that kx is actually k mu, x mu, it's a product of four vectors, so it's a covariant expression. If I write kx, it means k mu, x mu, okay, which you can write k0, x0 minus, if you are using the metric, plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, okay? So, and this could also be replaced by mistake, so let me H cross C square by V by operation number K, and is this with a, yes, that's what I have been doing. That there must be a square root. So I wanted to make sure if there was a square root here. So your first part in phi of x, this is called phi plus of x plus phi minus of x. Oh, let me speak a few words on this. This is called as infinite volume normalization, and this is called as finite volume normalization. So you can choose one of the two. Okay. Actually, the most standard books that I have been personally using for years, one of them is Lewis Rider, which takes, which always works in infinite volume normalization. And the other book, which is equally deep and thorough, is Mendel and so, and he always uses the finite volume normalization. But you can go from one to the other. It's possible to go this way, that way. All right? So this is just to establish equivalence to you, so that you read any book, but these are the only two normalizations that are in use. Okay, but of course these are only plane wave expansions that I'm using. Okay, all the way up to string theory we will make use of the plane wave expansions like that, but in principle you can use here cylindrical waves, you can use here spherical waves as you like. Okay. So they are further generalizations. I mean, you have more factors.